When the Lord says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength, that means this. He has 100% total occupancy of my heart, my mind, and my soul. There is no space left for anything else to occupy in my life other than Jesus Christ and Him crucified. There is no room available. There's no room available for anything else. He has complete occupancy of my heart and of my soul. And if He has complete occupancy of my heart and of my soul, then there is going to be an automatic pouring out from that heart and from that soul. And the sign of that automatic pouring out of that heart and soul is loving your neighbor even as yourself. And I gotta tell you, I haven't been doing it. That's what he means when he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul. It means that you're completely occupied by him. There's no room for anything else. There's no space available. No vacancy. That's what that means. Now let's read what the good lawyer, the Sadducee, had to say. Well said, teacher. He's so cocky. Well said, teacher. Now you understand there was some space also between verse 31 and 32, right? This wasn't just automatic. The Lord was done and then he spoke up. There was some space in between there. So after there was some dialogue and he went to his other lawyer friends and to the Sadducees and to the religious leaders around there and they discussed among themselves. What do you think, man? I told you you shouldn't ask that question. I told you you shouldn't ask the question. But you went ahead and did it anyway, didn't you? Dude, I didn't know he was going to say that. I mean, yeah, well, look what the mess you've got us in now. The fine thing you've done. Okay? How are you going to answer that? Okay? I mean, if we answer that different anyway than what he answered it, we're in a heap of trouble from the rest of the people. Now look, the fine mess you've got us into. Now you just go back and you just settle it with him. So then we have verse 32. Well said, teacher. The man replied, you are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. And to love him with all your heart and with all your understanding and with all your strength and to love your neighbor even as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. Folks, the Jewish community has no clue, even to today, what that man just said. He just admitted. And then the Lord's reply to him was, when Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you know what, dude? You are not far from the kingdom of God. You are now not far from the kingdom of God. You're right. The answer you just gave, wise teacher, is that what you just said is far more important than burnt offerings and sacrifices. Wait a minute. That's what we're all about is burnt offering and sacrifices. And now you mean to tell us that burnt offering and sacrifices don't mean anything anymore? That the religious activities that we go through on a daily, on a weekly basis doesn't mean anything anymore? That what defines us as a people,
that what defines us as a church, that what defines us as a culture, that what defines us as a movement is no longer important anymore. That does not matter anymore.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. Real quick. No, I'm here. Let me read this and then we'll be done. What did the Lord say? The Lord said, you are not far from the kingdom of God. What does it mean? What do you mean by you are not far from the kingdom of God? Did he mean that you're not far from being a Christian? You're not far from being a believer? This is what he meant. You're not far from having a vision of God. You're not far from seeing me. The kingdom of God was him. The kingdom of God was standing right in front of him and talking to him. And when he said, you're not far from the kingdom of God, he meant you're just about this far away from really understanding and seeing and having a vision of who it is that's actually talking to you. That's what the Lord meant. You see, patience is not the same as indifference. Patience conveys the idea of someone who is tremendously strong and able to withstand all assaults. Having the vision of God is the source of patience because it gives us God's true, proper inspiration. Moses endured not because of his devotion to his principles of what was right, nor because of his sense of duty to God. But Moses persevered because he had a vision of God. A vision of God. I'd like to think that I've had visions of God in the past. But you know what? My past visions of God is not the vision of God that God wants me to have of Him and the vision of Him that He wants for me in the future. He wants a brand new, fresh, current, right now vision of Him. He endured us seeing Him as He was invisible, Hebrews says. A person who has a vision of God is not devoted to a cause or to a particular issue. He is devoted to God Himself. You always know when the vision is of God because of the inspiration that comes with that vision. You know you've got a vision of God because with that vision comes an inspiration with it that is boom, that is explosive to everything that I previously thought was important and necessary in my life and for meaning in my life. That new vision brings about a new inspiration for a new set of priorities, for a new set of outlook, for a new set of behaviors, for a new set of beliefs. Hallelujah. And you know it's from God because it comes with an inspiration that is absolutely unrelenting and it's compelling you to press forward. Somebody say amen.
Amen. Jesus.
Christ needs to wake up. In some ways, we're just pathetic. Listen to me. Don't just pray for my healing. I appreciate that. I'm thankful for that. But how I want you to pray for me is that God fulfill your vision in our pastor. That's the prayer I want you to pray for me. Did you hear what I just said? Pray for me that God will fulfill his vision in my life for me. Because that's going to impact you. And that's going to impact this community. And that's going to impact lives. And that's going to impact the kingdom of God. Yes. Kidney, whatever. Amen. Flesh, whatever. Do whatever. But most of all, fulfill the vision. Fulfill the vision that you've given me of God. And when that vision is fulfilled, then they will know that I am your disciple when I show my love for everyone else. That's how I want you to pray for me. Because that's all that matters.
Amen. Yes.
I'm just about done. It's kind of a trip, isn't it? This God thing, living for the Lord. You come to church, and you come to church. People suffering, people going through things, hardships, shortcomings, tall grass, short grass, fruitful trees, barren trees. I heard one say the other day, you know, you have these people in the world that complain today, they say, they cut down all the fruit trees and they say, where's the fruit go? They cut down all the fruit trees and they say, why don't we have any fruit? You know, when you appropriate this, and which gets more rid of God, and then you make this decision and gets rid of more of God, and then when you put this person in leadership who gets rid of more of God, and then you establish this policy that gets more read of God, and then you create these laws that get a little bit more read of God, and then you have the church and the body of Christ who doesn't want to be too offensive, so they get rid of a little bit more of God, and then we look around and go, why is the world gone crazy? I tell you, the world gone crazy because there's less and less of God. God, fulfill your vision in me. That's my prayer. Somebody say amen. Let's all stand.